I'll read you the one of the ITAR messages to the world. It says, taken together, the ITAR members, a tokamak reactor intended to create fusion, represent three continents, over 40 languages, half the world's population, and 85% of global gross domestic product, all for this purpose. In the offices of ITAR, organizational central team, and the domestic agencies and laboratories and industry, literally thousands of people are working toward the success of ITAR. That's just one reactor trying to create atoms on fire. After 40 years of fighting for life on Earth with you, the reality is I did do all I can realistically do for you. And that's because you refuse to participate in defending our world by establishing what has value instead of want. You want what you want. It's all that you want. You don't want anything else. Well, this is what you get. So, reality then states to you, unless you try to stop those who are intentionally planning on, working on, using machines to ignite atoms on fire, unless you stop them, our world will end. That's not a game. Just look at the evidence. It's not an illusion. Look at the things they state. The purposes of their heart. If they have one. The machines built by universities for that purpose and governments funded by counterfeit money prove it is so. They are trying to ignite an atomic fire. That means burning atoms on a planet where made of atoms. So everything is fuel. We can't put it out. And it's just not going to magically extinguish itself. The sun would prove that. Wrong is a dead world. Our Earth becomes just like the sun. That's the possibility. That's the reality of their ignition of atoms on fire, which we cannot put out. Therefore, our world becomes the sun. And it will explode, taking the solar system with us. Nothing could be more disrespectful for life than gambling everything on Earth on the idea, the theory, that there's not enough gravity here to sustain the fire, so it'll just, you know, go poof and put itself out. We can't control atoms on fire. Everything is made of atoms, which means everything is fuel. I continue to provide information for you on www.justtalking5.info and its associated sites. I have provided videos which you can look there free, but as described on Just Talking 5. Or you can go to youtube.com/Jim Ostber, Ostrbur. All the rest of whether or not we live or die as a world, at least based on atoms and everything else actually that's a threat, is up to you. I have been fighting with you for 40 years and rejected at every turn. People have simply ran away to hide. It's not what they want, so they run away to hide. But you can't hide from an atomic fire. You can't hide from an Earth becoming a sun. If you won't fight for this world, it will end. So says the evidence. That's the facts. The reality of our time is it's our choice to make them stop or let them continue. That's, you know, that's my description to you. James Frank Ostrer on this date, November 2nd or 1st, 2016. Your scientists and your universities are never going to admit they were wrong. They control too much money. They literally gain too much power and pride. And they literally make up stories so they can continue in their fantasies and, you know, you can continue in, you know, your belief of, as a cult. Anything they say is true. Isn't that so? But they have discarded every physical law and every physical reality and bent every story to fit their purpose, which is to, you know, play with their fantasy that they can have an atomic fire on Earth and control it. They can't. Wrong is a dead Earth. wrong as this Earth becomes a sun. Our only real defense, legal defense, is to demand a courtroom and identify, make them prove what does happen if atoms ignited on fire simply do not extinguish themselves. What happens then? The answer is that there's fuel for the fire, so the fire continues to burn. They can get a legal moratorium making them stop, making other countries stop, and cut down their electrical service so they can't experiment anymore. That is the only legal way to find out for yourselves. Your entire world literally depends on that answer. You can't stop once the atoms are on fire. Every other option dies. You can't turn back the clock and extinguish a 10 million degree flame. A candle flame is about 450 degrees Fahrenheit. Compare that to 10 million degrees Fahrenheit. You can't even approach it. The three most dangerous machines that you'll be seeing on the back are trying to ignite that same fire as is on the sun here. Atoms on fire. Doesn't matter what they say, it's atoms on fire. The scientists at the Max Planck Institute in Germany say they have successfully conducted a revolutionary nuclear fusion experiment using their experimental reactor, the Wendelstein 7-X, WS7X, Stellarator, they call it. They have managed to sustain a hydrogen plasma, which means the gases that it means that they're approaching the point when atoms are going to be ignited. That is a key step on the path to creating workable nuclear fusion. According to them, fusion, the nuclear reaction that powers the sun and the stars, is a potential source of safe, non-carbon emitting and virtually limitless energy. Harnessing fusion power is a goal of ITER, I-T-E-R, that's a French reactor, trying to do the very same thing, which is to ignite atoms on fire, which has been designed as a key experimental step between today's fusion research machines and tomorrow's fusion power plants. They want to use the fire to run power plants, which is it would be a very big heat source with very little fuel and very little pollution. The only problem is, instead of fusion, as they claim, it's burning atoms. You can't, as we've discussed, the sun isn't as simple as they try to make it. Fusion is not two hydrogen atoms, combined into a helium atom. And we'll go to the idea for the National Ignition Facility, NIF, which is renamed, or that's what they did call it, at Lawrence Livermore Laboratories in San Francisco. Their statement is, it grew out of decades-long efforts to generate fusion, burn, and gain in the laboratory. Current nuclear power plants, which use fission, or the splitting of atoms, to produce energy, have been pumping out electrical energy power for more than 50 years. They say by achieving nuclear fusion, burn and gain has not yet been demonstrated to be viable for electrical production. For fusion, burn and gain to occur, a special fuel consisting of hydrogen isotopes, deuterium, and tritium must first ignite. They want to make a sun with this. A primary goal for NIF is to achieve fusion ignition, in which more energy is generated from the reaction than went into creating it. The National Ignition Facility tried now for over 3 years to ignite atoms on fire by this method and failed, with temperatures of 180 million degrees by their estimate and 500 billion psi according to them. It does not matter what method they insist will be safe. The only thing that does matter is these scientists are trying to ignite atoms on fire. Same as the sun. You can look up to the sun and say, is this all this heat from 91 million miles away, is that the result of putting atoms together, making a helium atom? And of course, helium is nowhere to be found realistically in the universe. It's one of the scarcest elements there is. And if every star was producing helium, this whole universe would be filled with helium. The sun does not produce helium. And that's absolutely clear. Where is the helium? Do not accept any other conclusion. No other conclusion is real. Your universities want the same heat here as is on the sun. And we could generate a lot of electricity with a little pollution and a little mining and a little anything if we did that. But we cannot stop the fire and we cannot control it because burning atoms, which is what the sun does, clearly by the energy released, it burns atoms. That means the sun isn't so simple as, you know, we're going to add two and two together, or one plus one of hydrogen plus hydrogen equals helium. Helium is not being produced on the sun. If it was, helium would be everywhere. It is not being produced on the sun, which is what they call their fusion. If that's not what's happening, then their fusion is a complete lie. Think about that. Your world depends upon it. Oh well. I got a little problem with the computer here. Atoms, when they ignite on fire, will be unstoppable. Your universities claim it's not that simple, but reality very simply says the energy and the longevity of sunfire, as is proven by what's released here on Earth, does prove that atoms are on fire. Nothing else contains that kind of energy. We know it's atoms on fire. We know it. You know it. They don't, because if they did not have their fantasy, they would not have all the power and the pride and the money to go ahead and make experiments and pretend they can be kings and queens and play God. They have to modify reality so they can play God. Otherwise, you know, they lose their job and they lose the chance to play. They want to play. Unfortunately, they're now gambling with every living thing on the planet, even the solar system. It is an abomination in real terms. Courts, media, leaders of all kinds have said the university knows what it is doing. They're not going to help you. They didn't help me. When I demanded that people at least have a right to know what's happening, he said no. Which means to survive, to put out this fire before it starts, we the people must legally rise. That requires your participation, your communication, your choice for life. As a secondary protocol, it also requires First Amendment legal redress of grievances. To facilitate that, I have withheld taxes for the purpose of trial, simply to the employees, obey the Constitution. Establish redress of grievances, and I will pay the tax. I don't mind paying tax for a government that I support. Democracy I support entirely. This is not democracy. Counterfeiting would prove that. And the Federal Reserve documents prove they are counterfeiting. The Constitution establishes redress of grievances. It is not the right of any employee, not the right of any judge, to say no. It's the law. They must do so. To prove that, I docketed two cases in the U.S. Supreme Court. Docketed means this is set for trial, only a judge can dismiss it. All of the requirements were passed. Everything was fine. The judge has to take a look at it and provide either a trial or the reason why a trial should not exist legally, not just because they don't want to. Each of these trials was dismissed by the secretary of the court. No judge signed them. That is actually treason, which means they are still literally, legally undetermined. You can bring them right back into court, both of them, and demand this shall be answered. You can do that. You can look at www.justtalking2.info to find those trials in the little 08, 13-something and 11-100, I believe. Anyway, you'll see them on the front page. The sun has flames estimated to be 1 million miles long. An atomic fire is gambling with this entire world. Everything lives or dies based upon a single experiment which does ignite an atom on fire. Our moon is 250,000 miles from us. Fire goes 4 times that distance. Think about that. I demanded of the courts, we the people must be informed of this risk. It is our extermination if they are wrong. We are involved. They are murderers attempting it. The court said no, as did media and other leaders. The university knows what it's doing. Well, it's your turn now to ask them to identify what goes wrong. I did what I could do. I honestly feel I can stop now. This is the first time in 40 years I really think so. Because the choice is yours. I made my choice 40 years ago. Longer than that, actually. Demanding that, wanting weapons of mass destruction to be stopped. They've started building these machines to ignite atoms on fire 40 years ago. Nobody cared. There are lots more threats as well, but they don't matter unless you change this one in particular. Every day, people try to ignite atoms on fire. Currently, every day, today, tomorrow, the next day, they try to ignite atoms on fire. We cannot survive atoms on fire. That is simple and plain, and you know it is true. You know it is true. If we ignite atoms on fire, which is what they're trying to do, everything here is fuel. It's all fuel. You too. It occurs to me that I would be remiss if not reminding you of the biblical book called Daniel 12. Well, the chapter Daniel 12 is, which gives an ending to life. A prophecy states, when the daily sacrifice, which is an honest respect for life, you know, an honest respect that acknowledges this is a miracle. We don't have to be here. This is a miracle. And the great abomination, which is the end of that, you know, they combine into the same thing. It's a great abomination today because men have created and are now gambling with the entire planet. They made machines capable of destroying every life on the Earth, even this solar system, by igniting Earth into a sun. Think about that for a second. The evidence proves they're doing it. It's not a game. It's not an illusion. The first date of usage in the first of these machines with National Ignition Facility, which can ignite atoms on fire, was April 1st, 2011. April Fool's Day. I suspect not an accident, clearly intended. Surprise! Oh well. Regardless, this starts the countdown at that moment. 1290 days have already passed. And the Bible calls that the first death, which means humanity during that time could have stopped those people from playing with life, from playing God, from demanding that they can control atoms on fire, but you did not. You wanted to wait and see. Well, you can't wait and see, but you did. So that time has passed. Then it goes to times, or, you know, according to that little thing, is times is the next 1335 days, which is the biblical story calls the second death, which means, like the Bible, the first part was about the law, the second part was about mercy, or Jesus coming and providing a different way for people to think. All right, well, we're in that right now. The next is our halftime is ends, you know, it just divides I don't know which you divide the 1290 or the 1335 or add them together. I don't know what that actually which one it is. But the halftime ends in, or the whole thing ends in March or April of 2020. And I do have it listed as March 2019 on a different area, but I think I made an math, touched the wrong key on the calculator or something. Nonetheless, I do believe the correct calculation is March to April 2020. Oh well, you should think about that. But it says the second death ends at 13 and 35 days. Well, the second death, if you go add in the 1290 and the 1335, you end up in, I think it was April 2018, as the last date humanity gets a choice and makes a difference. And beyond that, it's what will happen with or without mercy. So your time isn't quite to 2020. That's just as you see the end result of what you did decide come up. Well, that presents the possibility. The Book of Revelation presents the possibility for a new world order at the at its last endings. 20 or to 22. I'm not sure exactly. And that makes the end result of our time entirely dependent upon your choice and your participation. Realistically, what happens to us will be determined by what you decide, in large part. Biblically, by prophecy, our world is expected to end in 2020. Your opportunity to decide or participate in that outcome by change in yourselves will be determined on or about April 21st, 2018. That's the biblical prophecy of Daniel. More simply, our world will experience massive change in humanity. That means you, leading to a completely different experience of respect for life and respect for each other, or you won't survive. So says the biblical prophecy. As in, more simply, change or die, it's your choice. You really should, consider that. Change isn't so bad. All you have to do is, to prove it isn't so, is to provide, demand that the evidence is not correct. Prove the evidence isn't correct. That isn't so tough, is it? Is that tough? Proving the evidence is correct or wrong? Go to court, investigate it, examine the reality of what we are doing or what the university is doing. Examine the reality of adding another billion people to the population in less than 10 years, and another billion to the population in less than 10 years after that, and so on. When compared to the idea that, in fact, we have a billion people already hungry, just think what that's going to be for the environment. Global warming, water supplies are ending, food is being mutilated. Genetic researchers, they take genetics, the genetic code, which is the building of life, the building of bodies of life. And they throw junk into it. What do you want somebody throwing garbage into your motor instead of oil? How do you think that'll work? It won't. And they rush right out once they do it. If anything survives, they rush it right outside so they can infect all of nature. Nature is the genetic code because the genetic code builds the bodies of life. So without fantasies or lies or theories unproven, you can decide for yourself what is true. After all, it's your life. You're going to live or die accordingly. You might as well decide for yourself what is or is not true. Because if you continue on as you are, completely uncaring about what your gods at the university are doing, then hell is going to arrive. Armageddon means that nature is in chaos. Hell means insanity has risen to the point where we know we are fell into the trap, and there's absolutely nothing we can do to get ourselves out of it. That is hell. The apocalypse, of course, is that everybody has a gun or a fire or a bomb or something, and they all shoot at each other because they figure life is over. And life will be over once we have consumed every life, and we eat life. So when we consume it past the point where it can rebuild itself, or consume it too much and then have a disease wiped out, we can't rebuild that. So we have no food, and then, the water supplies are ending, and we're going to have no water, and it's just endless. Well, it's not endless, but it's terrible. Every fact that does matter to life on Earth has been hidden by media, and the courts, and your legislatures, and others. They don't want you to know. Well, you better find out for yourself. There's no mercy after these things pass the point of no return. You don't get to wish it away. You don't get to pray it away. You can pray now. You have a chance to change your future now. Yeah, I think, maybe not. The point of no return is certainly close. Really close, when nothing we can do is going to matter. When it's over, whether you like it or not. And it doesn't matter if you're poor or rich or a criminal or the greatest person on earth or whatever you want to think. It doesn't matter. We're all on the same ship together. We're all on this planet. And if the planet is burning, or if the planet gets thrown into war, with weapons of mass destruction coming close behind, we all die. It's not a game. This is not a game, and everything that threatens us does matter. Where our opportunity to make better choices will soon be over. And that's just because that's what the evidence says. Has nothing to do with what I want, what I don't want, that I don't go for want. What is or is not true matters. Whether you like it or not is absolutely irrelevant. I'm going to add, for the sake of the religious, that if you allow yourselves to be simply drawn into, is this, biblical, or is this, not biblical, or is this right, or, any of the little details that liars and failures and fools will try to draw you into, that means you've avoided intentionally the reality that people are trying to ignite atoms on fire. And you're avoiding the reality that we're going to add another billion people in less than 10 years, and you're avoiding everything important. What does matter is what ends life. That matters. Your media says only the entertainment matters. Or they try to make you fear in some form or fashion. Oh, isn't this terrible? And darn little less. Doesn't really matter which religion you are. We all die together. World only ends once. And it will end with atoms on fire. You can debate the prophecy and whether it can end or not. But you can't debate the ending. The ending will be real. You can't debate the ending of life on Earth. It's a reality that cannot be avoided beyond the point of no return. I'm not the issue. I'm just a messenger, if you can stand that idea. And I say that only because what I bring to you really does seem like it's a message from God. I mean, end of the world. End of the world. By people trying to ignite atoms and fire and all the rest of it. You know, one last chance. I am believing that that in one form or another it is directed or given to me to bring to you by God. You can make any decision about that you want. It really doesn't matter to me. It absolutely doesn't matter to me. That is irrelevant in many, many ways. It is. This is the construction of value as found in the biblical books of Revelation. It is not viewed from a religious standpoint, but instead looks to the question presented as the end of the world. Contrary to what people decide as the university knows everything position of this whole society, the reality of extinction looms large to us, particularly when confronted with the ignition of an atomic fire. Just like the sun here on Earth, they're trying to do that at Lawrence Livermore Laboratories. They're trying to do that in several places around the world. They have machines that can. That fire obviously burns atomic bonds, and the sun burns your skin in summertime from 91 million miles away. That fire started here on Earth. Cannot be simple or plain, other than it can't be extinguished. It burns atoms. Everything here is fuel. That's how it is. That's the facts. How is that not important to you? Media, leadership, courts, policing, religion, etc. all say the universities know what they are doing. Nothing can go wrong, or more simply, the university is their god. They're letting them gamble with the entire planet, every life on it. God here means they can't be questioned. These are superior. The believers, which is all of leadership, are like those in every religion. They just want what they want. It's that simple. That's the plan. Or more simply, if we want it, we must believe it is true. Ending with, let's lie so we can prove it is true. Then these fools who doubt can't complain after the fact. Even though nothing on Earth, law, life, physics, or any other form of intelligence suggests an atomic fire will extinguish itself, they simply believe. Hiding these facts that they are gambling the entire world, so none of us can object to this game of life or death for our planet. JustTalking4.info reveals some of the problems that they have just overlooked and refused to acknowledge. However, truth says there are no second chances. Once an atomic fire is ignited, we are all doomed. It's not a game. The universities say this 10 million degree fire will just extinguish itself. That is their only plan. There is no other. It is an end of the world scenario. Consequently, if religious prophecy is true, there will be evidence of this therein. Clearly, the potential end of all life on Earth, even the planet itself. So this begins the look at biblical prophecy to see what fits. This is then a fight for all that is beautiful, the realities of our world and our lives, the sanctity of all life itself, the values and realities of existence for our planet. This represents a demand for the fundamental respect granted and owed for what is true to nature and planet, as is the creation of this world. God, which means power and understanding beyond all human comprehension, did build this for us with knowledge, understanding, wisdom, and love, establishing through respect for us all and respect for every life on Earth a foundation that works in the freedoms to be happy, the realities of value, and the decisions to be an individual within ourselves. There's no other version of existence that defines life. Thought designs, and we have lived within it. The body is absolute proof of design and engineering far superior to anything men can do, as is all of life and its nature here on Earth. The universe's claim with evolution, chaos built this, while even their own definition of chaos is destruction. That does not equal to life. What if there is no female? What if there is no milk for an infant or a womb? What if there is no recognition of a need? What if you do not know how to breathe? Every part of life is a recognition of thought that exists. Evolution says no brain until the end, which is utterly untrue. Can't believe any of it? Well, then look into a nursing home and see what the loss of even a little perfection would be. Is. Armageddon, which means nature is now in chaos, is coming because of what men and their universities and genetic mutilation are doing, along with a lot of other consequences to chemicals and everything else. Nonetheless, today we examine the biblical book of Revelation for content and accuracy. The questions or predictions are, how can this be interpreted? The answer is, we now have the tragic means to make it come true. Why should this be concerning 2,000 years later? The answer is, absolutely nothing regarding this prediction could have been imagined in that time. When does the predicted end occur? Answer, according to Daniel 12, another Old Testament book, it is impossible to have imagined reality. That date, last chance for change in humanity, is April 21st, 2019. It's the prophecy. I have no opinion other than it's the prophecy. Is there an option for life to survive? The answer is, Revelation is written in two parts. The second ending requires that women shall rule instead of men. The first grants us no option. If so, then time will be allotted for women to try. There is no possibility for men to continue to rule without horrifying extermination. This is the best they did do, and we stand at the edge of extinction. And why must the world come to a predicted end rather than just remain forever alive? The answer, because humanity, as led by men and their universities, are destroying life, nature, planet, and all respect for God. They are creating their own hell on earth by their own decisions. It would be more merciful to just die in a fire, all of us, than what is coming. But rather than a word-by-word compositional interpretation, this is a summary of influences, elements, and realities depicted by prophecy that are sufficient to understand the prediction is real. We begin with chapter 1, verse 1, to reveal what Jesus intended for us to know. The critical relationship is that love brought us here, and love will bring those who accept life as love and truth first through respect into an eternity with God Almighty. That is his lesson. Or more simply, even though reality states we are alive as a body on earth at this moment, there is life beyond death of that body. That life begins in the essence of thought, which is the very foundation of life itself. Life exists because we know it exists as a relationship to our thoughts. Not because the body exists. Without thought, life itself cannot be. The brain is not life. The brain measures time and translates our relationship with thought to the body. That is the simple summation of the word called Jesus Christ. If you can hear it, it is because you respect life. If not, that too is your choice. We then begin with the seven periods or churches in time that represent how the people who did accept that presentation of Jesus as true turned into what they have done, turned into the realities of what they did do for this world and how it affects us. This begins with the prayer stating this book is from God. Seven spirits are laws elevated from truth which make life possible. We are then reminded of the cost accepted by Jesus and the reality of work and reward assigned by that truth, accept upon all who respect and order their lives accordingly. Then, a moment to be afraid, for there's no hiding from a reality that cannot be defeated, such as a nuclear fire, which means all fantasy must die. The writer then enters within an intense period of mental abandonment. Which means the hurt of humanity does not matter anymore, or there is no amen. Or what that means is we agree. Agreement doesn't matter. Only the reality of this moment, without known foundations in his words. These are, you know, written by his words. The writer John becomes adrift in what will be a tour of the future, according to what he can understand and then defined by a language and a world that he knows. He's not talking about our world. He has to translate it in his language, his time. The seven churches are the seven distinct periods of Christianity from its beginning to this day. His life, rather than his body, as in eyes, etc., the difference is spiritual. That is what the prophet is about. This is a spiritual thing. Then saw seven golden lampstands. These are the illumination of truths conceived by each representative church. Ask the churches what are the seven great truths of religion believes, and you have your answer. There is a man in this vision of the future representing a higher order of life or living or wisdom defined by the illusions he presents. What are the illusions? Are the imaginary soul of a man believes should be seen, what he believes should be seen, if this is from God. You all have opinions about if God sent somebody here on earth, he should be this or he should be that or something. Well, these are John's illusions of that. The real soul only accepts truth as it is, without subjecting it to human knowledge. This person imagined carries a double-edged sword, that is an ability to defend himself with words and that bite in, and are hard to defeat. He does represent a value of words, and reality is depicting this as a messenger of God. The writer then realizes this is not a game, and becomes afraid, because end of time on earth has become real. Life can die. The mystery of seven stars are called angels. An angel is always the truth revealed. Therefore, the summation of its work is to declare what is true about each period of Christianity. That reality also portrays the evidence of what can be found in the members of each progressive church, as some will be influenced throughout the ages and live or endure for God and Jesus like those who came before. This begins with the First Church of Christ. They grow weary, finding that their beliefs or expectations in want are not enough. You know, it's not what they expected. Time has passed without the expected reward. Even so, the promise remains. If you retain the honesty of your desire for life with God through Jesus, then that desire shall come true for you in death. The Second Church, humanity, has abandoned Christianity and made all who accepted that faith as their purpose in life to suffer. They remain faithful, however, and teach the world there is more to life than power or pride. Their reward is all suffering ends with their body gone. Eternity will be reward enough. The Third Church, liars enter the church congregation and do great damage to many. Those who have true faith hang on to that faith. Even so, want grows and people refuse to discipline their lives properly. There are consequences. Order refines life through law. Law grants that eternity can exist in thought, to remember through your faith. Look then to eternity rather than time. The Fourth Church, nothing is hidden from God. Traitors are among you and you listen. The seven tragedies of humanity are want, which is the foundation of all lies and liars, selfishness, which is turning your own heart into a prison, power, which is believing you can be superior, pride, which is assigning life to a game, arrogance, which is a developing disrespect for all life, greed, as in I want theirs too, and violence, is to abuse or use without justified cause. Then comes sex, the decision to accept love with value and heart, or, discarding that, it becomes simply body is enough, I want the chemicals. Those who retain order through respect and love within their lives shall rule society in the end. The morning star is an ability to see what the future will be through evidence and truth leading the way. The Fifth Church, most individual, plain faith has died. yet the church remains pretending for other purposes. The demand is, wake up, or eternity will shame you forever. Even so, a few amidst the many will in fact honestly have faith. To be dressed in white simply means untouched or repentant of the seven tragedies of humanity, including sex without love. Inside the heart, there must be more. This is a passion for the love of God and a respect for His creation, which does include women as equals with men. The sixth church is a congregation of individuals, people who belong to Jesus as a truth created within their own lives. This is done by understanding what has value: love, God, truth, law, discipline, order, balance, justice, respect, dignity, courage, Jesus, and life. Those who live here in this dimension of truth and value will be called priests or be entitled to live within a very close distance of God. The seventh church represents a time of human fantasies without substance, all of which are certain God no longer exists. They live under the assumption of wealth, but do not realize the lies which have already stolen everything called money. They are warned, buy from reality, change your lives, and construct the disciplines of order which demand life comes first, not money. Warned, accept from truth the disciplines that let you see life, environment, and the future as it truly is. This will not be easy, but if you are to survive as a world, it is the only way. Those who do this will be richly rewarded. They did do their part to save life and earth. Chapter 4 begins by establishing something entirely different, a new experience. This part exists after the seven churches have completed their journey in time. In the spirit means entirely dependent, without options, this truth shall go to where the journey proves itself to be true. The throne represents where God Himself sits to judge or control the universe. The 24 thrones sitting around God are the truths which govern this whole universe of time and life. The elders, which are proven truths upon the 24 thrones, are the laws built from those truths, which make them understandable to life. The seven lamps are the churches of Christianity. The seven spirits of God are the fundamental truths given to humanity that do include foundations for living, including everyone even beyond the Christian church. The sea of glass represents a purity that will not be diminished, proving who can or cannot come here. The four living creatures represent life in nature on earth. They all see. They reveal the predator. They identify the power. They recognize the wisdom or lack of it. They report what is conceived of as spiritual truths. From every direction in this living world, they search for respect. When they find that in humanity, truth will be worshipped, laws for justice will be formed. God will be recognized as true. Chapter 5. The scroll represents the decree, the demand of man, made this happen, for how the last days of leadership by men on earth shall be. Only someone who belongs to the life of Jesus shall be able to open that prophecy. Verse 6 identifies the body of Jesus, changed to include seven horns, given to mean weapons he now possesses, and seven eyes to understand what is true of all human existence. The life of Jesus, rather than the body of Jesus, takes the scroll, and all the laws of life and time bow down, which means he is given power over them, the right to judge. The saints rejoice. Chapter 6. The first seal. Those who call or consider themselves saints ride out into the world in a true effort to save life on earth, to bring respect back for God and planet. The second seal. There will be conflict and destruction because humanity wants what it wants. The majority of men do not want this change that women should lead. Because they failed, these are the choices they didn't make. To accept change means they have to accept they failed, and their pride will attack them. The third seal represents the judgment of humanity on this earth. During this time, concern arises for the food supply. The foreseeable reality has displaced fantasy, and the consequences of what men have done begin to show. The fifth seal, this is a time again for Christianity to be slain. The reality of hatred arises because eternity with God is not for many. They choose it not. It's their own decision. The sixth seal, nuclear war breaks out. Chapter 7 begins with the world stands still. An angel, a truth, coming from the east where the sun does rise, means knowledge begins anew. Time stops together those who shall inherit eternity with God. Everyone who can inherit eternity is found from both Christianity and other foundations of value, even in other religion, who now have faith in Jesus as their only Savior. Chapter 8. Death of a planet begins, one last chance to make yourself known to God, to accept disciplines for life ends. The planet itself becomes on fire, the very first part. The trumpets, the ignition of an atomic fire creates a massive updraft and a massive noise that sucks in everything with the atmosphere at first, discarding some of it back to Earth for a short time. The fire consumes everything in its path. It cannot be stopped. The second truth, mountains begin to crumble from the heat of a nuclear fire, causing them to explode because the thermal expansion cannot be moderated. They become boulders and rubble. People hiding behind mountains are swept away. The third truth, a nuclear fire means the pillar of flame. Scientists suggest that the sun, which is an atomic fire, has flames of a million or more miles long, with flares up to 12 million miles long. From that fire, now on Earth, it reaches the moon. The moon is sucked into the fire, and it ignites. Only a tiny bit of drinking water exists. Everything above ground has been sucked into the flame or ruined. The fourth truth, the fire now controls life and light on Earth, not the sun. Chapter 9. The fifth truth, the star is the moon. It adds to the atomic fire here, which now sucks out the oceans, opening the deepest parts of the planet to view. This, causing molten Earth to escape from the center of the planet due to the release of pressure. That release forms intense clouds of hot ash and debris, which then rain down upon what is left of this planet. Insanity and delusions overtake all life. The sixth truth, weapons from God, so-called, or more clearly, the heat of an atomic fire, and the release of pressure from within the molten center of this planet, now begins to destroy the planet itself, as literal pieces of Earth from all across the globe start to release and fly into the flames. It will be a massive effect. Humanity searches, but finds nothing to believe in. The flames will not be stopped. They can't, wish it away. Chapter 10, the mighty angel is the fire as it begins to pull on the solar system itself. Or more distinctly, the fiery jet that has come from the pillar of fire created now extends far beyond where the moon once existed. This begins to push Earth into the solar system in whatever direction it pushes. The little scroll means nothing much is left to destroy. The Earth and everything it was is soon dead. Only a sun remains of what the Earth once was. It will soon be destroyed too, because the surface is not consistent enough, not round enough to distribute the heat evenly. Therefore, it will explode. All of this because men thought they could play God with life and planet. Atomic fire, just like the sun, which burns your skin from 91 million miles away, is no game. There are no second chances. Once ignition occurs, life will be over. Men tried to ignite this fire every single day, even though they know this is true. They just believe it will extinguish itself because they want to play. Yet, men still could not respect life or planet. They fantasize about being God, and fight to prove their lies as if they are true. They want to be God. They still want to control a 10 million degree fire that obviously burns atoms for fuel. Because like nature itself, which is so obviously engineered by thought, a body cannot be mistaken as an accident. The universities still demand it's all just chaos that built this. Their God is chaos. And evolution is their God. And so many people believe them because they want what they want and nothing less than what they want. Which means they care nothing about life, only self. This seems great, that we don't have to care about anything, yet it leads them to horror and extinction. Seemed great to believe the university could solve every problem, but in the end, they killed an entire planet. Chapter 11 begins with judgment, measuring the value and the number of those who are closest to God, those who can be His children. During this time, which is preceding death of a planet, there will be very few who care, the majority who will believe they can and will play God. They will refuse reality with complete arrogance. Two witnesses establish the message, change, or the whole world dies. But they also represent a sign for peace, as that change, if it can be found, if humanity will search for truth and accept change, as in women leading, as if life must come first, with no gambling for the planet or its nature, or its genetics, thereby making decisions for the protection of life and planet, instead of what men and their universities do now. If that occurs, then life can go on. But that does require let women lead, because this is the best men did do. After thousands of years of trying, this is the best they did do, and we stand at the gate of hell. Even if you can't see it, it's coming. There is no mercy for that. Making decisions to throw the planet into chaos. Consequently, those who lead must be different than they are today. These two witnesses are not rich in terms of the world, but they do have truth on their side. Nonetheless, humanity believes to be from God, and they must have powers beyond anything human to make the people obey. Or can it be so? Even though nothing in the reality of Jesus on earth suggests this would be true. The entire New Testament is about Jesus and his ways. Like all biblical stories, this has a bent, John, the prophet here, towards what humanity is represented by this writer, wants or believes must be so. Because in their mind, or his mind, God is power, not love. Even so, it is still possible these traits could have been found and employed, however unlikely. Regardless, the witnesses are killed in a place which want controls. Want is an abyss, because it never ends, until you surrender that want in respect for life instead. The beast is pride. Pride must be the winner, or it is the loser. Sodom is a reality given over to sexual acts that are vile and degrading to life. Egypt is the place which enslaved the early people of God. The place which crucified Jesus is Jerusalem, or represents the Jews. The realities of want, power, pride, selfishness, and arrogance overtake men, same as at the time of Jesus when he was crucified 2,000 years ago. Nothing has changed. Or more simply, this is men demanding with their sword, "We don't want no damn change." Once again. Or, in another way, "We are God, the majority of people follow them, for they are a herd. You can't get me hidden among all these people." Once again, that's the reason people are a herd. You can't get me if I hide in all these people in their midst. Same as them. Anyway, after 3.5 days, these two, which were declared dead, will rise back to life and go into eternity. Proving beyond doubt their message, "Change, or the whole world shall die," was indeed from God. It is at the advent of that awakening, the resurrection of two who are children of God, that horrendous change for this whole world begins. The third woe, judgment of all human existence throughout time, begins. Humanity receives its reward, either for good or bad. This world is condemned and lost because of men and their ways. The book of Revelation divides here. The first 11 chapters identifies what happens if men remain in control. Chapter 12 and beyond represents what must or will happen if women are given the chance to participate and decide the fate of this earth with all its life. One or the other is allowed, but not both. Either women lead or there is no second chance. Unlike the first 11 chapters, which follow each other in order, from chapter 12 on, each scenario is largely separate. And that means each scenario may or may not occur. They are dependent upon the decisions made, not a succession. They are somewhat independent, therefore standing alone, as can or cannot happen, dependent upon choice. However, if a prophecy is entered into, it is unlikely to be impossible to stop. Chapter 12. The Olive Branch for Peace is Let Women Try. They are different, and for no other reason. They are simply different, and will choose differently. Heaven is a place we live with God inside our soul. The great and wondrous sign is that a spiritual woman appears with new possibilities for life to survive, such as let women try to lead. The people can see the potential of this understanding. The spiritual woman takes control over an identity of foreign life to her that has been visible to humanity since its beginning on earth. She controls then a man which is foreign to her, that is grasped but considered a very distant possibility, even if it is true. Nonetheless, this has in fact happened to me. I live with a spiritual woman inside, so basically half man, half woman, so to speak. Complicated. Her purpose is clear: to save this world by establishing different leadership. Women are different. That fact means they will choose differently. It is a fact, thereby a possibility in helping this earth survive. It's not what men would choose. The spiritual woman has already begun before being noticed with information that proves together they are not ordinary. The man and woman together. People who have heard their message, pregnant and about to give birth, do exist and have taken it inside themselves to consider whether or not it is true. They are few and of no influence at this time. The crown of stars are the knowledge presented for changing life and society on earth. 12 stars mean it is sufficient to achieve this goal. In this day, facing the divide between life or death for a planet, there shall be a decision made, a growing acceptance for what can be rather than what is now. Or if refused, that is a complete disrespect for life, as it gambles life itself with no real chance to survive. This is the trial for life, given a chance to remain as life on Earth, or a choice that convicts this planet to hell. Those in power with weapons and desires and knowledge for how to control humanity for fears oppose the spiritual woman and her chosen body. Hidden behind the veil of leadership and media is the reality of what is being done to thwart the message of change. Their purpose is to deny any and all transfer of power for life to life, by remaining in worship of money, producing power, and asserting pride. They are then claiming death for a world if they succeed. Their intent is to destroy change quickly, so change cannot take root and make living different a possibility. Their decision is to wait for a mistake so as to attack with a cause they can justify. But it will not be so, as the children who are able to hear and see will fight for life, will learn to think for themselves. They will find God inside themselves, and this will not be defeated in them. Finally, the numbers of voices heard, the people have grown in numbers for life, and for the sake of life comes forth. This physical man or spiritual woman will be required to flee. His or her job is done. The people must decide if they will pay the price of survival for this earth. It is no small thing. The same amount of time given to the two witnesses, the messengers of chapter 11, are allowed here, indicating one or the other decision by all of humanity will control this. Either male or female will lead to that future or fate. This decision will occur. It shall not be both, even though if women lead, men will work with them for justice and life, not as today where women are largely cast aside. The world itself teeters on life or death as humanity decides this. Every single day, the universe is trying to ignite an atomic fire here on Earth, bringing the sun here once ignition occurs. 1 second too late, and all decisions are over. The Earth then dies because the fire will not be put out. This begins the reality of crisis, which grants no one an excuse. Either this world shall change, and women will lead, because we must have different than this, or the leadership of men shall continue as they are, creating a nuclear war and achieving the ignition of atoms which incinerates this earth with fire. A dragon represents the terrors of the night, the shadows lurking in the darkness of an imagination. The prophecy is with light of reality visible, as created by truth, revealing all fantasy and failure, the power of man to lead ends. Prophecy is that Christianity shall play an important role in this battle. Prophecies are predictions rather than facts. Even if they are built upon facts, it is humans who will choose. The failure of men means those men who had power now want it back. They will come in force to manipulate, change, and control by fear, with words and media, or whatever it takes to get their power and their pride back. But those who can understand what true change means, when life comes first, will refuse that. Understanding money shall not rule us anymore. What that will mean is life comes first. They refuse to surrender power and pride and selfishness. Their own possibilities for superiority and control diminish in a different world, where life is the value, which includes them and honors us all as well. Change is significant and justice is true. Some will recognize that it is the life and thereby teaching of Jesus that establishes this potential. So say the messengers. Some will not accept it. Even so, those who have life inside will see truth, will understand consequences, and choose to fight for their world, their lives, and their children. They have no choice but death. Ignition will occur. The machines say it will. Failing to regain their power to play God on earth as completely as before, those who live for pride and power turn their attention to finding the woman who physically represents leadership for this change on earth. The woman escapes to where there is little for her and must endure. The time for to be endured is depicted as 1260 days, times 2 is 2520 days, plus half that original time is 31,150 days. She is then found because a flood of money will betray her whereabouts. The attack words and realities by those who want to play God again comes from all sides. However, by this time, reality is proving everything she has said was a threat is real. Consequently, the attack fails to unseat the demand for change. The power mad then attempt to regain control in other ways, finding Christianity, even all of religion, as a target. The desire for life, respect, dignity, love, justice, and freedom is universal and remains steady. Chapter 13. The desire to rule, as is power and tyranny, the foundations of pride which are to win and make the others lose, and the fundamentals of selfishness, it's all mine, as are also very serious about keeping their grip on power on this world, on the domain of power over others. They want it safe from that attack. The sea is money. The dragon is fear. Portrayed to the people as you cannot win. They bring their university weapons of mass destruction to prove you have much to lose. The attack is with hate. You're inferior to us. But they know as well that nobody wins this war. The beast is, I need no other thought to survive than to destroy. These are a second set of attackers, men intending to remain in power. Their weapons of war are a true physical threat. Their first battle is lost, but they do not surrender, turning to the decision to fight again with weapons of mass destruction. When the whole world is astonished, that means something very tragic has occurred, as in war with any part of weapons or mass destruction. Released. The world becomes afraid. The universities who have built these weapons believe they've won. You can't defeat us now. We are the saviors of this world, or it's Satan, in real terms. We are destroyers. That makes the armies involved arrogant and proud for the 42 months declared. During that time, both the universities and the armies involved pretend they are God, which does include trying to exterminate religion and take everything they can. Some people of life will survive, some won't. It is a time of tragedy, but there are no excuses. Life or death for this planet comes through here because men make it so. Change is not an option, it is mandatory, regardless of the cost. Or the whole planet dies. There are too many threats. Verse 11 changes the situation with a different form of leader, someone who combines both army and university. He controls the army, he controls the universities as well with powerful weapons. Fire in the sky is likely to be lasers shooting down satellites. He orders the illusion, that would be the exawatt lasers, for instance. He orders the illusion of universities as God shall be worshipped once again. He gives great power to the armies to take whatever they want. These set out to rule the world by claiming ownership over all life. The number 666 represents that they do possess great power over this world. The weapons are real, realities are tremendous, and we have little but the reality that we must stop them. To a great degree, this is already so. What happens in our future reality depends entirely upon you, and whether you are willing to surrender money, power, or pride, and do the work that is necessary for life. Chapter 14. The rise of life by those who are willing to sacrifice everything for a better world begins. It is a small army, built from those who accept eternity, shall in fact be their reward, but it is enough. They are given weapons which cannot be used by any other, never before seen on earth, I do not know what. This does make them courageous. The man John, writing here, believes that women are less than men, but he is wrong. Nonetheless, it is the teaching of Jesus which joins them all together. Their hearts are given to God. These warriors. Verse 6, the first truth. Your time of true decision has arrived, and the world of humanity shall choose the destiny or fate of who shall be their God. The second truth. America will fail because the delusion is wealth, and the reality of university treason is complete poverty now exists. The third truth, this means if any nation or group or individual thinks to attack America in its disaster, they will meet with their own disaster even worse than the Americans. The warning is clear. Do not attack them. They have work to do. The religious within America will be in turmoil as well, as they too must decide if the university is their God or God, creator of this whole universe, is God. Those who accept faith and prove it is so will find eternity a joy. Verse 14, it is at the beginning of these things that a man is pictured before the world as someone hard to ignore, someone potentially identified as from God. A different truth comes from religion itself to accept the duty that is harvesting this earth. Even though the tool arises from the man's hand that's been pictured, the people make their own decisions to work for God in life or not. Another truth comes from religion, which is to condemn those who did not choose for life on earth. Another truth comes to earth with an internal torment which will attack those who fail to choose for life and eternity. Their pride and want will cause tremendous grief inside their own existence as they realize their eternity is lost. The numbers of the lost are great. Chapter 15. This begins with the power and desire of purity, but mixed with fire means trials and tribulations remain. It is written for those who belong to God, who first accepted the university as their God, but repented. It is the consequence of believing so devotedly in a lie, even though you have repented and now revoked the university as God, that you will endure trial and tribulation. Chapter 16. Seven truths exist as the choice which conceives of seven plagues, dependent upon what is chosen. The first truth is the skin disease, or any disease which erupts from the skin, as can be caused from a variety of sources already here, particularly chemicals, certainly the mutilation of genetics. The second truth, the creatures of the sea will die. Man has taken too much, they cannot survive. They are no longer food for you. The third truth, the drinking water is lost for so very many. The fourth truth, ozone ends, bringing a shower of radiation upon the earth. That's a potential. The globe overheats, or global warming. That causes plants and life to die, climates to change, bringing droughts and floods, etc. And then a reality of cascading changes to the life chains that keep us alive. It can also be the sun turns supernova, but it's unlikely. The fifth truth, the throne of the beast is university genetics. Tragedies will come because of what they did or did not choose to do. They cannot turn back the mutilation of life. Men who gamble, this is our God, find themselves in turmoil. The primary cause here of genetic mutilation, the reality of life dying, is now beyond stopping. Food supplies are being destroyed. People blame God for what they did themselves. Genetic chaos has a cost. Yet the people continue to believe in the university demanding they must do more genetic mutilation to save themselves. That's what they think. This appears to be a war against life, very similar to biological weapons of mass destruction, which would be a little worse. Sixth truth. World wars break out. Barriers are lost. Insanity reigns over men because nature falls into chaos, the result of genetic mutilation or poisoning by chemicals which causes genetic mutilation. The whole world is angry at their leaders and attack them, and the leaders attack them back. It happens very quickly. The seventh truth, God takes control. This begins with the draining of the Great Lakes, which causes a sudden release of energy as the bottom of the lake falls into the mine below it. That then triggers the Yellowstone supervolcano to erupt, an earthquake that follows, and the result of this volcanic eruption causes devastation around the world. Chapter 17, the great prostitute is America. So says the description of this day. Read it. It is one of these seven truths or angels that occur before this happens in America. It is unclear which one. A different truth then appears. The writer goes to a place that cannot be found unless you are allowed by God in the Spirit. The woman is pictured sitting on the powerful men who are extremely angry and think only of death, but they cannot throw her off, even though every possible attempt is made. The woman is dressed in every sign applied to royalty in this time and nothing less. She holds, which is not a part of her, a cup. In that cup are the tragedies that men create against women, including their scorn, just for being women. The woman does not simply honor those who believe they are the children of God, just because they are religious. The men who are religious, which means rules, obey our rules, hate her, as she will not obey them. The mystery is, why is America called the mother of prostitutes, now declared as a tragedy to this earth? The answer is, from the universities here, they have infected the world with chaos and treason of a wide variety of sorts, causing money to fail. They are terrorists, trying and gambling with our entire earth, every life on. World terrorists, or its other name is called Satan. The mystery of the woman is, how did she become able to control, if not defeat, this beast? The answer is spiritual. The beast which ruled the world, as university knows everything, does lose power, but want will drive them back to try again. The people who step back from worshiping the university as God are now not so easily deceived. Verse 9, the seven heads represent the very foundations of what and how the university became powerful. The seven heels are the obstructions, developments in truth this woman has placed before them to impede their power and their travels. The seven kings are those who gain power because the university rules society and governments. Five have fallen, indicates their power from the universities has failed them. One remains because it is more needed by society than the others. One will come because society needs a solution. The power as has been to do anything the university wants will end. We then turn back to the originating beast who is so angry it is ready to kill. Verse 12 refers to weapons that are powerful rather than words which can lose. That threat becomes real to this world. The universities control them, and the people who want their lives without change and their future back to play God themselves must make a decision. They assume killing the spiritual woman or physical man, whatever you call it, who started this, is to be their answer. The woman of the great city is a reality of truth that builds for life respect, law, and justice. That is what these others are truly fighting against. Verse 15. Truth states the power of change to change that was brought to this earth by the woman was for life on earth to do better, to be better, which men have called a prostitute, for making them pay for what they want. They want to continue with power. They want to control and have pride over all life, especially women. They are confronted by these weapons of mass destruction that are aligned with men and their universities. The intent of men at this time will be to ruin her because she demands them to stop the reality of their own ways. They now face a new reality. By assuming her death is their friend, they assert their problems will just disappear once the woman is gone. Their hope, their purpose, is to eradicate everything the woman brings to demand life must come first on earth. Equality will be required of men for women. No exceptions. The writing then changes to the originating or actual prostitute, which is America, as a foundation for this beast, for those who are proclaiming to be God here, as is the universities. Chapter 18. Another truth begins. The opportunity to accept knowledge and understanding leads to the choice which we must make these changes as is necessary for us all to survive. The consequence of that is all fantasies must die, including the counterfeiting that has kept America from the truth. They are, in fact, completely bankrupt. Their power ends. This is a choice to be moderated in a bankruptcy by becoming we the people. But if not, it will happen soon either way. Bankruptcy is coming. Far more tragic if it is a simple and true complete collapse of the economy rather than a moderated change by we the people in control of our own lives. Verse 4, Stop weeping for what cannot be saved. Accept this punishment to begin saving life on earth. The world will not weep for you. The tragedies which extend from this will be harsh, but without moderation, the potential for chaos and civil war multiplies. That will cause the other nations to weep, because now this collapse affects them as well. Other economies threaten to collapse around this world. Food disappear. There will be heartache even around this world. Even so, those who have been trampled on will rejoice, believing now you suffer too. Another truth appears. War against America looms large. They were cheated. It may be that nuclear war ends America itself, such as the hatred released. You stole our money. All because the American universities who control government could not control themselves and bankrupted the nation and every person in it. They made the money worthless. Even its religion is leading all into chaos. In fact, exporting their delusions, our debts don't matter, let the slaves pay, to others, other nations who did the same. This is predicted to be bad, that nuclear war ends America forever. It may or may not be true. Chapter 19, the power of America is over. The universities and those who use power against life are dead. The laws which govern this earth agree the possibility for rebuilding with respect for time, life, and this earth and God is over. This in turn now arises from their disgrace. Another truth appears. The possibility to rebuild individual lives is given through Jesus. The few who remain want women to lead now. Now they desire true peace, finding only your own soul knows the truth of who you are. What shall be is determined by who or what you worship. Truth will decide the future, your future. Eternity is based upon truth. Verse 11. The options are, at the end of all major tribulation, to accept the purpose of life is to be honest, faithful, and true to both life and God. That includes being diligent about keeping God, truth, and life first, at the forefront of every decision. To do so means you shall inherit eternity. Verse 13, the robe of blood identifies the cost is a lifetime, while the reality of that grants an intellect which knows that what truth is. Few choose it, many follow. Humanity follows to belong within the grace of God, as has been seen, heard, and understood as a true value. The only King of Kings and Lord of Lords allowed within the New Testament is Jesus. You will bear in mind that life is not body, as is nature. Rather, life is the realities assigned by thought that give us recognition to understand we are, in fact, free within the boundaries that keep us alive. Verse 17, although greatly embellished, still describes the changing of life from what has been to what shall now become new and different upon this earth. Even so, those who demand power, pride, selfishness, and the rest that made men their leaders on earth now see this as their last chance to save what they desire from extinction. That men lead, they lose, and all great armies die. All worship of university fails. They are watched and warned. Never do this again, or it shall be very bad for you. Chapter 20. Another truth. Those who want must surrender their purpose, as is selfishness. Accepting truth, life, love, and justice will be their passion and desire instead. At 1,000 years hence, the earth shall be all used up. You know, there's a limit to what there is here. The consequence of that is want will arise again, but since there is no solution, it will fail. Verse 4, prior to this second ending for earth, should it survive this first ending of what cannot be anymore, or we end now, those who fought to save this planet and its life shall immediately go to God at their bodily death, the ending in their time. At the end of the 1,000 years, those who can shall go to God. it will then be similar to the rise of Jesus at that time, because the earth must be abandoned. This is the second death of earth, because the first, killed by men or not, is being decided right now. It won't be two, just one, if you kill it now. The next 1,000 years shall be different, or they will not be at all. Respect, love, and truth shall rule them, or the earth and its life will fail. Regardless of men or women, you must respect, love, and accept truth shall rule, or it ends. We are too many people for any other way. Verse 7, at the end of 1,000 years or thereabouts from today, with the earth completely used up by humanity, the demand for more for myself, yourself, and the realities of want shall again appear across this planet. Which means justice, truth, love, and life comes first will again fail in men and women because they face a certain death. Therefore, insanity rises. God is again attacked as not here, doesn't care, can't save you, but they're proven wrong, and salvation for the rest is proven true. Verse 11, judgment day for all who have lived, eternity is revealed. Chapter 21, the end of human need now changes our existence. The women shall be true to respect and for life first. The men shall be respected for who they are. The time of trial for all mankind is over. They have made their decision and shall inherit their chosen truth. However, those who fail to live a proper and pure life, even in this place, shall be destroyed or displaced from it for the sake of the others. Verse 9, when the second death is over, and those who could not live as God intended for our lives to be are removed, it is then that Jesus will become our guide. Those who are pure enough in their heart, soul, and desires will be able to enter into his kingdom. It will be impressive. Chapter 22, those who have entered within the kingdom of Jesus are granted the right to be true children of God. They are forever granted the right to choose life as they desire it to be, even for themselves, across the universe. Verse 7 to 21 gives cause to humanity throughout the ages that have passed, a warning: always be prepared to meet your Maker. So ends this book of the Bible called Revelations. Leaving you with this decision: are you willing to let your university gods be wrong? Are you too willing to gamble all life on earth by letting them ignite sunfire, same fire as on the sun, here on this planet? Knowing that there are no excuses, there are no second chances. If this fire they try to ignite does not extinguish itself, then we are all lost. We all die, every single one. Even the planet, forever. Even the solar system, in fact. Only a cult cannot fully and deliberately question its leaders, particularly on such a question as this. Only a cult worshiper cannot decide for themselves what is not acceptable. Only a fool refuses to believe what is important, true, and without options to avoid. These things they do are truly life or death situations for our planet and ourselves, our children and their children, and any life on this planet. There's no coming back from genetic mutilation. There's no coming back from all the threats that exist. Try going to JustTalking4.info or JustTalking5.info or any of its other sites. I have provided them for you. Make your decision now that life will come first, as our world depends upon it. If you don't, there is nothing to believe from reality that it will not all be lost. Everything will be lost. including you. As for me, for 40 years or more, I've been working to enlighten humanity about coming threats of extinction. Beyond numbers useful to count, people ignored these facts, refused that evidence, decided only wanton greed do matter to them, and thoroughly chose to believe whatever they were told by the experts on TV. Regardless of what other experts said, because they want what they want and they believe in TV. Therefore, they can assume nothing could be done anyway, so why should they care? They have an excuse. Even though the machines to ignite an atomic fire were coming and are now here, they still refuse. Led by media and its experts, by believing in their God as is, university knows everything. Prior to the addition of Spiritual Woman and me, having diligently searched for a solution to help life survive, I found none in man, because men will always return to what they have known throughout history. That is proven true again and again and again. I demanded of leaders of all kinds that they must obey the law, protect life, and inform the people of the risk of all these threats present to our future. Realities of our own extermination. They all refused. The policing agencies and the courts were informed. We have rights. No one deserves, no one has the authority to gamble with all life on Earth, to risk extinction or extermination, by fire especially. The law forbids it. They refused. Instead of realizing blind obedience is for fools, they assumed I would attack them instead. Because the cult, those who cannot question their leaders, just didn't care about evidence or truth. Not a single one. That leaves nothing but war in the mind of man. It is the male solution. Throughout history. Kill it and it won't come back. If I had chosen to make you listen to these threats by force, nothing good would have happened. People heard together. Everybody the same when they feel threatened. Leaders would have ensured nobody hears why. War meant absolutely no opportunity for this world or its life to survive, as would be consistent with the two witnesses in the first part of Revelations. What man can do for themselves is then nothing. War solves nothing. It only kills or destroys. Or stops someone else from killing or destroying. Which is never... what it seems like it might be. So I searched for the spiritual door of women to ask, what would you do? Because with a resounding no, all women did refuse to help me, those that I questioned. Mine was just a question to women, spiritual women, for all life to survive, what would women do? But that was not enough in the spiritual realm of women, of what is true for women. They desire change. Reality says they deserve change. They deserve to lead now. It is simple. Men threaten their lives too. They brought us here with their decisions through a university diploma. That begins what is consistent with my own life as it is developed into this day. The assertion is that leadership does not extend to women own it all, as men have done. Nor can they lead as men, picking just one to make these decisions. They must do this for together, with men helping. Rather, while working together as male and spiritual female, the combination of both has solved many problems for life and society, granting the opportunities for understanding and change to all who care. These elements of change are displayed on the various websites that I have provided. Spiritual woman leads me, but I participate. The decision to save life on Earth is mutual and simple, and the reality is I failed. So she has a right to lead. But I have already done the work which makes it possible to understand direction. It's complicated, but nothing else could have or would have presented you with this opportunity to save Earth and life itself. So many threats. Overpopulation, starvation, thirst, mutilation, atomic fire, and many more exist as true. Each requires a new choice. Each requires a new direction. Each demands, without justice for all, that truth must lead, fair play must rule, and respect for life and God as our mandatory, or this world will die. You have many threats. This is not a game, as is so clearly demonstrated by the fact the ignition of an atomic fire will cause this earth to become another sun. There are no second chances. It cannot be extinguished. That fire on our sun, we know it exists, is the burning of atoms, which makes everything here fuel. That is true. The universities are not God. They don't know everything. They are, in fact, by the evidence of all these threats and realities of lies, hiding it to be Satan. It's a religious word, but it fits. Your American media is not to be trusted either, as their exclamation, "All that and all that matters," is in fact an admission of guilt. Nothing that truly matters is reported. And all they do provide is a little entertainment to distract you from our true reality, to keep you from fighting for your world so you may survive. They are an impediment to your life. Leaders have completely ignored life to worship money, as nearly all people do. They will argue we take extreme risk in genetics just to fight for a life. Not true, as these risks are clearly intended to destroy all of life instead, rather than save just a few. It puts everything of nature in jeopardy of chaos. And they do know that this is true. Evolution is their religion, and they are trying to prove their God, which is chaos, is real. Well, chaos will come. Better stop it now. Religion lives in worship of the university, or, you know, in their terms, they are the answer, as is so clearly evidenced by evolution within their religions. Nothing is actually more corrupt than evolution. Nothing is more simple to understand is not true. Life is not built one piece at a time. You need all the parts and pieces and software to run it at once. Can you get in your car and drive it without a motor or transmission or tires or anything else? No, you have to have them all. The courts are corrupt and do commit treason against life and democracy. The money is gone, proven true by the Federal Reserve. The university diploma stole it. They stole it all. There isn't any more. All that and much more, because the university diploma is literally in charge of America, which means this is exactly what they did choose. This is what they chose. We are surrounded by threats of extinction and world extermination. It is the one unifying factor which ties every direction man has taken together: a university diploma. They are responsible, but so are you, or worshiping them, or believing in their experts, regardless of the evidence. Why do people believe? Well, it's for a few toys and trinkets. But mostly, it's a bribe. Even though the citizens of America only receive a trickle of all that is counterfeited and sent around this world. You have to change all these threats of extinction or you will die. It's not complicated. Simply choose to believe the evidence instead of their claim as is to know everything. They don't. The words which plague God by proclaiming to be expert are not enough. Even though they know nothing of importance to life itself, they are immersing you in their lies, such as all the fake theories of how the sun works. They literally keep you adrift. No, you can't know the truth, and helpless. Only the diploma can decide. Until they literally do destroy this world, now it's too late. How is that not Satan? Every true threat is being helped to the point of no return very quickly. We can't survive overpopulation and all the rest of it. We must stop these threats. The result, it's too late now for all of life on Earth. We'll die, is already dead. Must be stopped. The only way you can stop it is to start questioning it, investigate every threat that exists, examine what happens when this goes wrong, and make better decisions. As a world. It's a fact. If you can't believe that, simply begin with asking your gods at the university just how will they extinguish a 10 million degree fire. It's not fusion. Lawrence Livermore Laboratories in San Francisco, who declare they can create a temperature of 180 million degrees at a pressure approaching 500 billion PSI with their 192 lasers all pointed at the same spot, has already proven this is false. Fusion does not exist. There is no doubt about it. The sun burns atoms. Well, more correctly, the bonds that hold atoms together. You must make a better decision than your experts and diplomas can make. They have brought you here. That should be cause enough. You will die if you don't. This entire world. That is the price of being wrong, with experiments so extreme that the whole world can be lit on fire, with genetic mutilation so extreme, our entire relationship with life can be exterminated. Make a better decision. It's your life.